Now, this first group that's coming out is one of the most outstanding groups of gospel singing and entertainers in America today. We're always happy to have them come across the Mississippi River over to Texas and entertain the people here. And from Atlanta, Georgia, I want you to make welcome the old windjammer of gospel music, Wendy Bagwell and the Sunrisers.
If that don't tickle us to death, we'll never die. I'll tell you that. We appreciate that. You know, I was just kind of looking over this crowd a little bit before ever we come on, and I just wonder how many of you ever stood in the hot sun watching the best friend you had in the world finish off a Pepsi. And wouldn't even save you a sip. Now, if you've been down that road, you come up as poor as I did. And I wanna tell you a little thing here. I don't wanna get you all sorry for me or squalling or anything like that. But we was really poor. I remember when I was a kid, I had to go through a pretty good neighborhood to get to school. People used to call their dogs in, afraid I'd give them the mange or something. And you know, I feel like kids today really don't believe, my kids don't believe me when I tell them how poor I was. They come home grumbling about what they had to eat in the cafeteria at school. The closest I ever come to getting to eat in the cafeteria at school, I used to go down there at lunchtime and stand in the door and smell it as it come out. And kids were stingy when I was a kid. Nobody'd ever give you a bite of nothing. One person in our school I ever remember giving me a bite of anything. And we had this girl in our school named Corrine Cunningham. And every now and then, she'd give me a turnip green and biscuit sandwich or something. And then you had to get downwind of her to eat it. Oh, Corrine had an odor so bad, if you could have canned it, you could have won a war with it. And you know, and this is a fact what I'm telling you with my hand up. We had this kid in our school named Wilbur Wingate. They used to bring the most beautiful lunches of anybody ever knew. And I used to always stand and watch him eat it. And I used to beg him for some of it. I mean, look, I was hungry. I always knew what I was going to have for lunch at school, nothing. And I was hungry. And I used to beg old Wilbur for some of his lunch. He never would give me any of it, but I never really gave up. I thought someday he would. And one day I was begging him for one little bite of his lunch, and he went into school and he told Miss Hayes, that was our teacher, and he told Miss Hayes on me. I was scared to death of that woman. He come back out there and told me, said, Miss Hayes won't see you in her room right now. I went in there scared to death. Miss Hayes was one of these teachers that could paralyze you with her eyes. And I went in there scared to death. She said, Wendell, That's my name, Wendell. Everybody got to be named something. She said, Wendell, have you been begging Wilbur Wingate for his lunch? And I said, no. I was bad to lie when I was a kid. She said, well, he says you have. She says, as a matter of fact, I got a telephone call from his mother yesterday, and she asked me to ask you to bring your own lunch. And I thought to myself, big deal. So tomorrow I'll fry my sock. Mm-hmm. Well, I despise that little old stingy Wilbur Wingate worse than anybody in the world. The very next day, he come to school with the most beautiful weenie I have ever laid my eyes on. It was even in a weenie bun. Just like you get in a restaurant. It had ketchup, mustard, and onion on it. And I went out there to watch him eat it. And old Wilbur took that weenie. He laid it down on his sack on the table. And then he turned around to open up his potato chip. Well, when old Wilbur turned around to open up them potato chips, I just scooped me up a handful of sand, and I went right across the top of old Wilbur Wingate's weenie. Well, he turned around, picked that thing up, and bit down into it. You ain't never heard such spitting and spluttering in all your life. He started squalling, went running to that school just as hard as he could go after he'd done throwed that weenie in that garbage can. He tore off to that school, and I knew I was in a mess of trouble. 2 days in a row where Miss Hayes didn't get it. Well, I went in there. I don't know if you ever had your hand bent over as far as it'd go, and some teacher take a little. You have, haven't you? Some teacher take a little old 1 foot oak ruler like that right there and go to work on the palm of that hand. They don't know when to quit. They'll beat you. You can feel it from your nose to your toes. Or pull up that back britches leg and go to work on that calf. You been there too? I went in there and there stood Miss Hayes, big as life. She put them paralyzing eyes right down on me and she said, "Did you put sand in Wilbur Wingate's weenie window?" And I said, "No." She said, "Now listen to me." She said, "Every day I have more lunch than I can really eat." She said, "Why don't you just let the other kids go outside? You hang back and eat some of mine." Well, there ain't no way I'd have sat down and eat with no teacher. But it did show me one thing. It showed me Miss Hayes was on my side, not Wilbur Wingate's. So when I went out in that yard, I want you to know I was a-feeling it. He is standing there still sniffing and snotting around. I run right up to him and I said, "Wilbur Wingate had the weenie. Someone filled it full of sand. Wilbur Wingate's weenie wound up in the bottom of the can."